It was all filled with integrationists. We were going to make a difference in the world. It was also an inner city project in St. Louis. Well, I heard a big buzz at the pub, and I was a very curious child, and I heard and saw this money. And this money was going to take all the blacks back to Africa. If you wanted to go back to Africa, you could go. And this money was going to get you there. Terror. Oh, my God. I don't want to go back to Africa. I don't want to leave my mom and dad, my sister. My dad and I were very brown. And see, in those days, if you weren't white, you were black. So there I was, this beautiful black child and her daddy, and this money McGovern and was going to send us back to Africa. So I had to scheme up a plan. They had a plan. I'm going to get one too. Dick Gregory and McGovern were not going to send me away. So I got up in the middle of the night and I packed a big bag of peanut butter jelly sandwiches on Wonder Bread. And I held him, and I waited until the sun started to come up, and I went, and I hid inside of my father's trash can. And I fell asleep. Crash! Bang! Ah! Oh, my God! Oh, what are you doing in there? Oh, Jory's dead! Oh, God, somebody go get her father! Oh! And I woke up, and I was shaking because I was so cold, and I had my grip on the bag. Oh, I wanted to bring peanut butter jelly sandwiches. And my dad comes on. What it? Explicative, are you doing in the trash can? And I pulled out my money and I said, see, Daddy, they're gonna send us back to Africa and I don't wanna go. And the security guard says, Jorge, I think you have to have a little very important conversation with your daughter. So I ask you, what was your initial impression of me? That fancy introduction? Those first impressions is where it all starts. That's the divide. That's the divide. Unchecked first impressions. It was so hot that summer. I was so pregnant. I was so pregnant, people thought I was carrying twins. Oh, and we had to go get grass. I said, baby, I'm so hot. Do I go inside and give me a bottle of water? And he's sitting next to me. He says, baby, I can't just walk into the store and get you a bottle of water. I'm like, oh, don't argue with me. Just go, I'm so thirsty. He says, Have you forgotten who I am? Go! So he walks in to the convenience store. Opens. Pulls out of water, starts walking toward the door. Excuse me, sir. I know you were meaning to pay for that water, right? Oh, my wife is pregnant. It's so hot. We're going to put it on the card. Sir, I appreciate what you're telling me, but you got to pay for that water before you walk out of this gas station. Child into this world with this hatred and this, these assumptions. The embarrassment and shame that I would send my husband into that store so that he could experience one more time again, and I'm just so ignorant and I'm supposed to be enlightened. Oh, the pain. I looked into his eyes and I saw his bright spirit. That I told you so. It stunk like a smoldering, nasty mold. Forgiveness. Where do you find it? Where is it? You're armored with so many stories of pain, frustration, the truth of it all. So we were in the doctor's office doing a monthly checkup for the first masterpiece I was cooking, and my dad came along. In those days, in the 60s, daddies weren't even allowed to say the word pregnant. Where did children come from? They didn't know. What do you do with them after they get here? That's Mary Bell's job. We're sitting there, and he looks at me. I knew something was up, because I could see it in his eyes. I could see this deep, deep, profound self-loathing. This deep, profound fear. And he said, baby, you know it's not too late. Come again. It's not too late, you know. You're not 12 weeks yet. It's not too late. I said, daddy, what are you talking about? He says, it's not too late. I said, oh, no, 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 no. This child chose me. Remember I told you I was in Jamaica? This child chose me. I'm having this baby. This baby's having me. He said, I don't know what I'm going to do. When that first person makes one racist comment about my baby, my firstborn grandchild, I'm going to come unglued. I'm going to kill him. I just don't trust myself. dad grew up in an orphanage. He was a Great Depression baby. Only Mexican family in the whole home, Christian home. His nickname was Nigger Baby. Sweet Jorge the Nigger Baby. That self-loathing was deep. So deep. When I said, Daddy, you don't have anything to worry about. You've got two biracial children. And we turned out just fine. He looked at me. He said, what are you talking about? Where do you get these ideas? I said, well, I'm a person of color. You're a person of color. Dad, you're full-blooded Mexican. I am not. And he called my stepmother and asked her, am I a person of color? I'm a white person, right? About other people. How dare you judge and not check your assumptions? That's too much work. Uh-huh. But if your gift and your goal on this planet is to be nothing but love to give away, a healing balm for every person that you come across the path with, then you have got to lay it down. Then you've got to do your work. You have to transform your soul. It's an inside job. I had to start with that self-love. Learn how to love myself. Boy, was I alone in that work. But when you get a taste, when you get a taste of the love and support that comes out of doing your forgiveness work, you are no longer alone. You're a community. And it spreads. It's like magnets. It's like, oh, I want some of that juiciness. I want some. Can I hang out with you? Oh, yes. And we do that work together. Side by side, arm by arm, tear by tear. And we wake up. And there's an Antioch waiting for us. A TEDx Antioch. Saying, please come join me. One voice. Let us heal our community. And let's start with forgiveness. It's a beautiful thing. Have your assumptions changed?